Good evening, good evening. Hey, we are so glad you're here this evening. We're so thankful for you, so excited you're here, and what a special time we're going to have together as we have this night of worship. I want to first of all just welcome you, but second, I want to let you know that the bathrooms are located. If you go out this door to your right, and then if you go out this door to your left, you'll have some access there and some opportunity. And then I just want to say thank you to this incredible choir and orchestra. Can you go ahead and give them a round of applause for all the work they put in? Yeah, it's good. It's good. But more than welcoming you here and welcoming them here, the best guest of all, we welcome Jesus. It says where two or more are gathered, he's here with us. And so we rest on that promise. So I'm going to pray, and then they're going to get us kicked off. It's going to be such an incredible night. Some of my friends are here to share with you. You're going to hear testimonies. You're going to hear songs. You're going to have the opportunity to sing along. And we pray that tonight would be a blessing to you, an encouragement to you. But also, more than anything, we pray that if you don't know Jesus, when you walked in this place, you know him before you leave, all right? So let's pray. God, we love you. Father, we thank you, God, for all that you're about to show us, all that you're about to teach us. Father, we thank you, Lord, for being the King of righteousness, the King of peace. Father, we thank you, Lord, for giving us your peace, not the world's peace. We thank you, Lord, for how you'll use music, song, speech, your word, the Spirit of God through each and every element, Father, to teach us more about our God, that you would teach us about salvation through Jesus Christ. Father, that you would teach us about the eternal promises we have so that we would run this race with perseverance. God, help us to keep our eyes on Jesus and help us in that process to see him clearly tonight as he gathers with us. We welcome you here, Lord, and we thank you for these folks that are here. God, we pray blessings on them. And Father, may they be encouraged. And Father, may we be established and built up on your word tonight. Father, we ask all of this in the great and powerful name above all names, the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you.
I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever. Every day I will bless and praise your name. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. And his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall declare your works to another, and shall commend your mighty acts. On the glorious splendor of your majesty, and on your wondrous works, I will meditate. They shall speak of the might of your awesome deeds, and I will declare your greatness. They shall pour forth the fame of your abundant goodness, and shall sing aloud of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in love. The Lord is good to all, and his mercy is over all that he has made. All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord, and all your saints shall bless you. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom, and tell of your power, to make known to the children of man your mighty deeds, and the glory and splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures throughout all generations. The Lord is faithful in all his words, and kind in all his works. The Lord raises up all who are bowed down. The Lord is near to all who call on him. He hears their cry, and he saves them. My mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, and all flesh bless his holy name, both now and forever, and forever, and forevermore.
Says in the book of Hebrews, chapter 1, long ago, at many times and many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets, but in these last days he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed as the heir of all things, through whom also he created the world. He is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of his nature, and if he upholds the universe by the word of his power. After making purifications for sin, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high, having become as much superior to the angels as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. We worship Jesus tonight. And we invite you to join with us in singing. So would you stand?
Fall down and worship, to sing the song of ages to Usually I get up here to sing, but I'm not going to do that. And actually, this is more terrifying to me. I'm going to try to stay on point because my mind races and it's a little faster than my mouth. But when Ryan asked me if I would do this, I said, no, I don't want to. And in a few minutes, I'll tell you why. I've shared this with Chad before. I said, I don't think anybody wants to hear my testimony. So please just show me some grace. First of all, God is good. I grew up a military brat. Emphasis on brat. I don't know if you guys know what brat is defined as, but it's a disobedient child. Well, I'm here to tell you, I'm still a brat. Maybe not to the same extreme as I was when I was little. But I disobey God all the time. So I guess the definition still stands. I was raised where God and church were turned off and on like a light switch. One day we would be all in and say, hey, we're gonna go to church, we're gonna live right. And a month, 2 months later, we wouldn't. Say, we don't wanna be a part of that. And I gotta tell you, that is no way to raise a child. Because it leaves irreparable scars. Being raised in the military, it also gave me the ability to pull away from people. People and places really easily, because I never knew how long I was going to be there. So I never got attached. Unfortunately, this kind of raising and behavior also bled into my spiritual life. When strife and turbulent waters come around, I would just run. I would turn away because it was easy. Like I said, I didn't want to do this, and I'm going to tell you why. I was the worship leader at a church for a few years, and I was asked to give my testimony. So I did, at a youth event. Because I know what teenagers go through. I know what they're exposed to. I know how they talk. I know the things that they watch. I know the things that they listen. And some of those things can become addictive. And they did. So I stood up at a youth event, terrified as I am tonight, gave my testimony so that these youth would know that they're not alone in their struggles. And that they can be redeemed. And then I was politely removed from my position. As you can imagine, I was scarred. I still am scarred from that. Church is supposed to be a place where you can come and tell what's going on in your life and tell how God can save you. But then when you do that, and they ask you to leave your job because they don't want the youth to be exposed to that. Is that what we're supposed to be doing? If I can't come here to be healed, where can I go? What's the point? Amen. Needless to say, I pulled away from the church long after that. I fell into depression and disbelief. A disbelief in the church. Because how can you believe in a church that says one thing and says this is a place to come and heal? And then when you lay it out there, they punish you for it. I have been blessed, though. Amidst all this chaos and inconsistency growing up, God has blessed me. I have always felt the Holy Spirit pulling me back. Even when I drifted far away and I was in disbelief, I always had that pull. God has a plan for me. Hebrews 3:10 says, their heart always turn away from me. They refuse to do what I tell them. Well, that's what I was doing. I have done things and said things that are inexcusable. I have drifted to places that could not be farther from God. I am a very capable person. If I set my mind to anything, I can do it. God has blessed me with the ability to just pick up anything and do it. Unfortunately, when you have that blessing, it's also a curse because I feel like I can do anything. And that included living a life that I wanted and still being safe. I can't do it. Nobody can. I apologize, y'all. Sometimes I wear my heart on my sleeve and I just get emotional. God sent Jesus to die for us and do the thing that we are incapable of doing. The Old Testament is chock full of proof that we cannot save ourselves. We cannot obey God's word. We're incapable of it. We're cursed. So we can't let the devil get in our head and tell us otherwise. We can't let our ego get in the way. Hebrews 2:18 says, He himself has gone through suffering and temptation. He is able to help us when we are tempted. I'm here to tell you that I am still tempted every day. I have to monitor what I watch. I have to monitor what I listen to. Because even though my childhood is far in the distance, those experiences and influences are still here. They won't ever go away. I have to ask God continually to help me. Jesus has earned our respect and our love because he did what we can't do. I always struggle with my own inner demons, and I probably always will. But I try to remind myself always that Jesus has already won that fight. I don't know why I still fight with it. He's already won. He has deemed me worthy. Even though every day I feel like I'm not. I'm not worthy to stand here. I am not worthy for you all to just listen to me and give me 8 to 10 minutes. I'm not worth it. The things that I have done in my life, I'm not worth it. The people I have said goodbye to, I have ignored, I've just left so easily and dismissed. I don't deserve anybody's compassion. But he says I'm worthy. And that's all that matters. I have to remind myself of that every day. It is still difficult for me when troubles come my way to not just walk away. Because my whole life, it's easy. I've always been trained, and I say trained because that's basically what you do when you're in the military. They train you to just say, you can make new friends. It's not a big deal. Don't get me wrong, I'm not saying everybody in the military is scarred. But it affects people differently. And it affected me that way. Hebrews 4:7 says, today you must listen to his voice. Don't harden your hearts against him. I have been guilty of that many, many times. few years ago, I heard a song, and a lot of songs touch me. But this song, I would consider my life song, because it means so much to me. The lyrics explain it all. In the chorus, it says, I run to the Father. I fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding. There's no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, and my soul needs a friend. So I will run to the Father again and again and again and again. I've been told before, if you find a scripture that really touches you, try to rewrite it and make it fit you. Just replace some pronouns so it makes it personal. Hebrews 4, 12 and 13, I kind of rewrote for myself. It says, for the word of God is endurance. It is sharper than the sharpest knife, cutting deep into my innermost thoughts and desires. It exposes me for what I really am. Nothing in creation can hide from him. Everything is naked and exposed before his eyes. This is the God whom I must explain all that I have done. God knows everything I've done. And he still deems me worthy. I no longer flip that light switch. Church and God is not something you can just turn away from. It's either part of you or it's not. I thank God every day for pulling me in. Even when I just want to drift as far away as possible and disappear. God is good all the time. Thank you.
Thank you. Right. The last thing that you want to do is give a preacher a microphone and tell him he's got 10 minutes. So I was asked to share our testimony, and I thought about talking about the... I thought about talking about the church, and I thought about talking about my grandbaby. And then God kind of put on my heart to share both, so I'm going to share shortly. In about 14 years ago, God put it on my heart to plant a church. No money, no backing, just God saying, go. He said, I'll be your help. I said, God, we don't have the right people to help us. He says, I'm all the help that you need. So we started the church 14 years ago, and we started with 30 people. And to make a long story short, every time we needed God to do something, he did it. He did it in his own time. I tell Greater Fellowship often, I love the way God works because God can show up late and still be on time. We needed a building. We were in a storefront building. Church was growing. We had expanded into the other part next door to us. We had a wall knocked out, and the church continued to grow. And I went to God again, and I said, God, we need a building. One Sunday, I left service, went to Sheffield, and I rode around Sheffield, and God pulled me in a direction at a church that is called Eastside Missionary Baptist Church. I pulled up there and I prayed in the parking lot. And after praying, I left and I went home. Chad, for about 2 months, every Sunday, I would leave service, ride through the parking lot of that church, pray, and go home. So one particular day, I went there and I prayed, and I got out and discovered that spider webs were across the door. Nobody had been in. I went on Facebook and I looked the church's name up, and I called. I found a young lady who had been there in 2003. She said she had enjoyed service. Sent her a message and said, I need to know about this church, Eastside Missionary Baptist Church. She said, I'm not a member there anymore, but I can connect you with one of the deacons. One of the deacons I reached out to, and finally, he said, Pastor, we have been closed for about 6 months. And he said, we have one of our older preachers is gonna come in town and take the church over and get it back going. I said, well, have y'all ever thought about merging with another church? They said, no, we hadn't thought about that. I said, well, God told me that I am the man that's supposed to be there. He said, well, Pastor, we don't know what to tell you. He said, we're going to keep our building, and our old preacher is going to come back in town, and he is going to get the church back going. I said, well, just save my number. Another 6 months go by and my phone rings. He calls me and he says, Pastor Malone. I said, yes, sir. He said, about 4 months ago, we were having service. People had started coming back to the church. We were excited. And he said, the preacher stood up and said, God said, I'm not the man that's supposed to be here. He said that we've decided that we're going to sell it. I said, okay, how much? He said, we're going to sell it for $50,000. I said, that's a good price, but we've got a lot of young people and we don't have the money. And I told him, I said, God said that whatever we needed, he was our help and he would provide. He said, well, I'll go back and talk to the other trustee of the church. There's only two of us left. We'll talk and we'll pray and we'll see what God says. He calls me back, and a building that they were wanting $50 for, he said, give us $10 and it's yours. We started with 30 people, and to this day, God has blessed our church till we have over 400 members in Sheffield. Amen. I got time? Okay. So that was the first building God put our church in. We were excited about what God was doing. And one Sunday, matter of fact, I don't know if Brother Eddie is here. Is Eddie here? Okay. Brother Eddie came to service, and it was jam-packed from front to back. This little building that we were in only seat about maybe 90 people. The day that Eddie was there, it was every bit of 190 people. There were people outside the church who had put up lawn chairs to hear service in the parking lot of the church. I said, God, we need another building. I'm thinking we were going to have to build. Someone reached out to me, long story short, someone reached out to me about the York Terrace First Baptist merge. I said, God, if you're going to do it, do it like you did before so that others will believe you can still do it. And he did it the same way. Today we had standing room only, and we baptized six. A mother came. Thank you. God bless you. A mother came.
6 hours away.
A mother came 6 hours away to visit with her daughter, see her daughter be baptized. And today, this mother who struggled with opioid addiction gave her life to Christ and said, it's behind her. So I watched God work miracles in the life of our church. I knew he was a miracle worker. But then it hit my address. We got a call that my grandbaby that my daughter was carrying had a hole in his heart, was bleeding on his brain, had kidney issues, and was diagnosed as Down syndrome. The doctors said that if it was in our best interest to abort the baby. Through prayer, God told us what to do. He said, I'm your help. That was almost a year and what? Over a year ago. He has no bleeding on the brain. He has no hole in his heart. He has no lung condition. And what you see today is a healthy baby boy. So we had prayed, and I'm done. I think my time is up. We had prayed for a boy. We had prayed for a boy when we were young, and we were having babies and doing what married people do. And I'm sorry, I thought I was at thought I was at my church. I'm sorry. But we had two girls, and the plan was if we ever had a boy, we were gonna name him Major Dewan Malone. We never had a boy, but when my daughter had her son, She used the name that we had planned to give our boy. So this is Major Dewan Malone. I call him Little Preacher. God bless you.
Hey!
I told Ryan this morning I only had one problem. One problem. And that was, in the order of service, I was after the Malones. So we're going to ask that my help come from the Lord too, and maybe it would allow me to do such things. And to think that she can sing like that and still be one of the best teachers in the state of Alabama, in the nation, and doing a wonderful job. And we appreciate all you do very, very much. Their church has been such a blessing, not only to the people of Sheffield, but to our people and to the people here in this community. And we're so thankful your family's here. We're going to take some time now and unpack some biblical truth from this understanding that our help comes from the Lord. You see, as you walk and you journey through the book of Hebrews, what you see is that there's this teaching and this emphasis on the Old Testament. And you see that the author of Hebrews takes the Old Testament and he ties it together so that we might see the glory of God, that we might see the glory of God fully revealed in the person of Jesus Christ. But then he does that in such a way that he unpacks it and he says, but Jesus is better than the angels, chapter 1. And then he says, and Jesus is better than Moses, chapter 2. And then you get into Jesus is better than Joshua. Jesus is better than the Sabbath. Jesus is better. Jesus is better. Jesus is better. And then you get into chapter 7 and it starts to unpack that Jesus is better than Aaron the priest. And when it gets there, we start to unpack all of the theological ramifications of who Jesus is and what he means. And if you go back through the Old Testament, then you would understand that the priesthood had been set apart. You remember when Moses was called into the ministry and he said, but Lord, I can't do this. I can't do this, for I stutter. You have made these lips and they don't work right. And the Lord reminds him after he makes all these excuses, excuse after excuse, and God replies, I am with you. I'll speak through you. I'll give you the power to do miracles and great things for the Lord's glory and for his purposes. And they'll be unveiled before you. And then the people will know that the Lord is the God, that he is the one worthy of praise. And Moses says, God, please send somebody else. And he says, I'm going to send your brother Aaron to go with you. And he's going to be a priest. And then you start to understand as the word goes forward that these priests, they had a significant role, Aaron being the first high priest, and that they have this role where you understand as you read through the Old Testament that we are more drawn to prophets. We're more drawn to prophets like Moses, who spoke to the people on behalf of God, or maybe we're more drawn to people like Isaiah, who spoke for the Lord as a prophet, or maybe we're more drawn to Ezekiel and seeing what he writes and what he says to the people and how he tells them to get right with the Lord. And we're drawn to that over and over throughout Scripture. Maybe it's Samuel, maybe it's others that are prophets who are speaking on behalf of God. But yet here it is, this office of the priest. And it's those that represent the people to God. And they go on behalf of the people. And the Lord establishes a tabernacle. And everything in that tabernacle has to be consecrated by the blood of the Lamb. And everything that the priests have a role in has to walk through this very, very careful process of making sure that everything is set apart holy unto the Lord. And the way they would do that in most cases is that they would take blood and sprinkle on it. In fact, the people would line up and he would sprinkle blood on them, being consecrated as a holy nation and setting them apart for the purposes of God. And you would think, wow, Aaron is so fascinating that he has this role and he gets to be the first. Surely he did this well. Surely he did all these things that God asked him to do in such obedience that it would make us marvel at the goodness of God and allowing us to have someone who represents us to the most holy of holies, to the holy God of Israel. But then what we understand is that while Moses is away meeting on the mountain, meeting the Lord, and receiving the Ten Commandments, we understand what Aaron is doing, don't we? There he is, making a golden calf so people can worship something else other than God. And you would say, well, it got corrected after Aaron, because surely the Lord brought the smack down and corrected it, right? And we see with Aaron's sons then that they started to dedicate things on an altar and started a strange fire there. And suddenly a fire broke out against them because they had not approached the altar with reverence. And it struck them down. See, we could tell you about another priest, Eli. And Eli went before the Lord and represented the people over and over again, but Eli did not control his house. And so Hophni and Phinehas, his sons, grew up, and they were wicked before the Lord. And they thought the Lord's presence just could be brought in any circumstance, in any situation, in any time. And so they tried to bring that in against the Philistines, and the Philistines ended up winning that battle and taking the Ark of the Covenant, what signified the presence of the Lord. And the Lord does great miracles in that time as the God of the Philistines falls down in worship before the Ark of the Covenant. But again, there's priests that missed the mark. We could go on and fast forward to Zechariah. Zechariah is serving as a priest of the people, and he goes before the Lord, and an angel appears to him and says, Zechariah, you'll have a son. But Zechariah didn't believe. He didn't believe that God would bring about a great miracle in John the Baptist, his son. So the Lord struck him with an inability to speak. Until he revealed the name of that son would be John. See, we could fast forward then. We could go to Annas. And as Jesus stood before Annas, the priest of that day, we see that Annas didn't want anything to do with Jesus and what he was saying and the truth that he was proclaiming. And in fact, one of his officials ended up slapping Jesus across the face as he stood on trial. And then they sent Jesus over to Caiaphas. And as he condemned Jesus to be crucified along with the Jewish and the Roman people, as they gathered together, because that priest at that time in Caiaphas, he was more concerned about the things of the government than he was about the power of God and the salvation of men. And he lost focus in understanding what God had brought the priest to do. And so Hebrews talks about priest after priest after priest and talks about Jesus is better. And he says, but he does not come from the tribe of Aaron. He does not come from the Levites. No, he comes from a different order. Because Aaron and the Levites were set apart for this moment in the sacrificial system. But he comes from another nature. He comes from another lineage of priests, and that is through Melchizedek. So in chapter 7, we get to understand that the name Melchizedek means king of righteousness. And Melchizedek served as the king of Salem, which means the king of peace. And then the picture starts to unfold that Melchizedek's priesthood started long before the law was ever there. And what we understand is that this is the type of high priest we need. This is the one that we've been longing for. And so I take you now to Hebrews chapter 7, verses 26 through 28. For this is the kind of high priest we need. Holy, innocent, undefiled, separated from sinners, and exalted above the heavens. He doesn't need to offer sacrifices every day as high priests do. First for their own sins, then for those of the people. He did this once for all time when he offered himself. For the law appoints as high priests men who are weak, but the promise of the oath which came after the law appoints a son who has been made perfect forever. Later on, he would write, but Christ has appeared as a high priest of the good things that have come. In the greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is, not of this creation, he entered the most holy place once for all time, not by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood, having obtained eternal redemption. Therefore, he is the mediator of a new covenant so that those who are called might receive the promise of the eternal inheritance because a death has taken place for the redemption from transgressions committed under the first covenant. And just as it has appointed for people to die once, and after this judgment, so also the sins of many will appear a second time, not to bear sin, but to bring salvation to those who are waiting for him. And that's what we're doing tonight. We are currently waiting for him and his return. And then he would go on to write, the author of Hebrews, in Hebrews chapter 10, he said, for by one offering he has perfected forever those who are sanctified. Another translation says, he has made holy forever those who are being made perfect. I want you to understand the context. At this high priest that we have so longed for is not like Aaron, is not like Aaron's sons, is not like Zechariah, is not like Eli's sons, is not like all these high priests that had faults of their own and followed sinful ways. Instead, now he has allowed us to be made perfect through his great sacrifice, through his great atonement. Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have this promise, we have boldness to enter the sanctuary through the blood of Jesus. He has inaugurated for us a new and living way through the curtain, that is, through his flesh. And since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed in pure water. Let us hold on to the confession of our hope without wavering, since he who promised is faithful. See, just as in the day when they consecrated all the things and they sprinkled blood on it, you too have been set apart. A holy nation, a royal priesthood, set apart for his purposes. So when we sing, our help comes from the Lord. Oh, he has indeed. He has sent us just the high priest that we need in Jesus Christ, our Lord. So today we celebrate and we wait until the day he returns to bring us in full glory to himself, where he will dwell with people and people will dwell with him. There'll be no more pain, no more suffering, and there'll be a new heaven and a new earth. And until that day comes, we day by day and moment by moment approach the throne, not with fear, but with boldness, because we come through the blood of the great high priest, Jesus Christ. We love him.
Thank you.
Hebrews 10:23. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. May our confession be tonight that Christ is our hope in life and death. Would you stand and join with us in singing this great hymn?
Amen. Now and ever, we confess Christ, our hope in life and death. What a powerful way to have that song. And when we sing it, we understand that in the Old Testament, we see priests making sacrifices first for their own sin, killing animals, and then for the sins of the people. And now we understand the purpose and the role of Christ's death to bring us peace with God so that we could have a relationship with Him. And then He sets us out on a mission. And that's why when we get to Hebrews chapter 12, after we hear in chapter 11 how we're surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, and we have this history of people, life after life, who has lived with faith, and without faith, it's impossible to please God. So now by faith, we run a race. In Hebrews 12, it says, "Therefore, since we also have such a large cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let us lay aside every hindrance and the sin that so easily ensnares us. Let us run with endurance the race that lies before us, keeping our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. For the joy that lay before Him, He endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God," the right hand where He intercedes to this day for you as the great high priest, where He offers Himself as the sacrifice. And so in the Old Testament, we see that God invited Moses up to the mountain. In the New Testament, we see that Jesus Christ came down the mountain to be with the people. And what we see there is that now we're invited to the mountain of God, but we don't go with fear and trembling. We don't see lightning and everything shaking the earth. Instead, He has shaken everything from this earth, and He's shaken the heavens as well, so that what we stand on is something that cannot be shaken, the hope in Jesus Christ. What we see in the word from this writer of Hebrews, it says, "His voice shook the earth at that time. But now He has promised, 'Yet once more will I shake thee, not only the earth, but also the heavens.'" This expression, "yet once more," indicates the removal of what can be shaken, that is, created things, so that what is not shaken might remain. "Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us be thankful, by it we may serve God acceptably with reverence and with awe. Therefore, we may boldly say, 'The Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. What can man do to me?'" Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Now may the God of peace, who brought up from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of everlasting covenant, equip you with everything good to do His will, working in us what is pleasing in His sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. He is our fortress, and He's planted us on something that cannot be shaken. See, we have this hope as an anchor for the soul, Jesus Christ, our living hope. And I pray that if you're here tonight and you do not have that hope, that tonight would be that night where you would surrender it all and understand the fortress that is our God. Let's pray together. God, I pray right now, Lord, through the power of the Spirit, Father, that You would move among this people. God, that You would work in such a powerful way, God, that they may see their need for Jesus Christ, a high priest that would intercede and intervene in their life, that would serve as a mediator between God and man, achieving for us a righteousness that we could not achieve for ourselves by one sacrifice, once and for all. You've planted us, and You've given us a faith that cannot be shaken. So, Father, let us run the race with perseverance. Let us run with full confidence, keeping our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith, who's worthy of all praise. God, we thank You for such a fortress. We ask it in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you.
dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in whom I trust. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer. My God is my rock in whom I take refuge. He is my shield and the strength of my salvation. I call to the Lord who is worthy of praise, and I am saved. He reached down and drew me out of the deep water. He is a shield for all who take refuge in Him. For who is God beside the Lord? And who is the rock except our God?
Alone on the throne of heaven. So let's celebrate who God is and all that He's done, that His kingdom will reign forever. Would you stand and let us, this last song of worship tonight, let us lift our voices in praise to Him. So good. Thank you for being here tonight. It's a little longer than what we normally do. But oh, how good it is to walk through the book of Hebrews like this tonight. So thank you for coming and being part. I just can't thank this group behind me enough. For the group upstairs, everything that makes this possible. Appreciate Mike sharing his testimony and the Malones being here tonight. And they had to slip out because his grandmother is at the end of her life. And so you'd be praying for the Malone family. She is about 100, I believe he said. She's in the hospital in Decatur. So they had to slip out so they could get, hopefully, to see her tonight. So be praying for the Malone family. And I have one final word from chapter 13 at the end of the book of Hebrews. The writer says, "Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever." And all God's people said, Amen. Amen. Go in peace. Be blessed. Thank you for being here tonight.